So do you remember when we talked in the clinic about what the next step was in terms of surgery and how we make decisions? So our approach is a little different. There's many different approaches you can have with ovarian cancer. Some people do primary debulking surgery followed by chemotherapy. Others would do neoadjuvant chemotherapy followed by surgery in between, followed by more chemotherapy. And it really depends on patient characteristics as well as disease involvement. And I don't know if you remember this, but you're young, you're healthy, you thought you had ovarian cancer. So we talked about doing laparoscopy first to determine if we could remove all the disease
I
and
remember
then move
that.
from there, right? And you were having so many symptoms, you were really uncomfortable from your
Very
cancer too.
uncomfortable, yeah.
So I felt like it'd be worthwhile to move forward with surgery. So we did the initial laparoscopy. At the time of surgery, we did what's called a Fogarty scoring, which you probably don't remember that, which is
I don't. I was so out of it back then.
Yeah, that's okay. But we use a certain scoring method. And if it's a certain score, we say, hey, we can probably get all this cancer out. Let's go ahead and go for it. Or if it's a bigger score, then we know we can't remove all the cancer and do neoadjuvant chemotherapy. In your case, I did something a little different. You were having so much symptoms from the mass and the tumor volume that we went ahead and I got that out as best I could, but I knew I couldn't get all your cancer out to R0.
Yeah, I remember that.
And so we finished after that with a thought that we would do IV chemotherapy with bevacizumab to try to shrink down the cancer as much as possible.
Isn't that Avastin?
Yes,
Okay. All right.
yes. And then we came back a few cycles later and did the bigger surgery with the intent of removing all the rest of your cancer there and then doing the belly wash therapy.
Yep, the IP. I remember that. They had to roll me.
Yeah, so what did you think about belly wash therapy compared to the IV chemotherapy only?
Well, the IV was much easier, believe it or not. The IP, I was just a little squeamish, just having a port, I guess. So
Right. But you got through
I
it.
did get through
But
it.
it's
Yeah, yeah,
harder.
yeah. So for first line standard of treatment, I thought that was a really good call on your part.
Yeah. So and that's how we were treating everybody. We were really aggressive with intraperitoneal therapy. There have been so many studies supporting that approach and prolonging survival and disease control. And then just a year ago, they presented the new results on belly wash therapy, saying that if you combine chemotherapy, there's all these different chemotherapy options with bevacizumab, that there was no difference in survival between the groups, but no surprise, more toxicity with the
Oh,
intraperitoneal
okay.
therapy, which you lived through, so you
Yep,
knew
I
that.
did.
Yeah. And so at this time, we've moved away from that belly wash therapy. We're waiting for some more information and waiting for that trial. GOG-252 is a trial name. Waiting
Okay.
for that study to get completed so we know more about the survival outcomes. So ovarian cancer treatment, there's no one way,
There's
right?
so many different treatments out there. You just don't know which one to pick.
Right. And I'm sure as a patient, that was very confusing
It was
for
very
you.
confusing because, first of all, I've never had cancer before. This is all new to me. And you explained all these different treatments. I wasn't sure which one would be best for me, but you made good decisions on that part.
Thank you. So, after you finish the IP therapy, one of the big things we talked about is should we keep going with the bevacizumab for maintenance? And you're pretty tired at that point. One of the things I talked about with you, Michelle, and I realized I need to explain this better, was going back to the decision about proceeding with surgery or no surgery. And I talked about R0. And many of the people in our audience may be thinking, what on earth is
R0, that's what I
R0?
was thinking. What is R0?
So I apologize for that. So R0 basically denotes that you have no evidence of disease left. We removed it all and it is now completely gone and there's no evidence that we can see with the naked eye that there's any disease left. And then there's other R numbers that you can add in there that denote the volume of residual disease that's left if it's not R0. So that's the definition of R0. So you're done with your chemotherapy. You have no evidence of disease. You did do maintenance bev for a short period of time, but I think you just got tired and wanted to come off. How hard of a decision was that for you?
It was hard because at the time I didn't know all the other options I had out there. So if you're giving up one treatment and then opting for another treatment, you need to get your knowledge together and know if that's the right treatment for you.
And in that case, we did surveillance. We did
Yes.
the watchful waiting. Did you find that period of time that you were not on treatment as being more freeing? You were able to do things you wanted and didn't have to see me, or were you more anxious?
I was more anxious because I felt like I wasn't being proactive. just waiting. So I feel better when I'm on treatment because I know that I'm being proactive and doing something.
Mm-hmm. And that's really interesting. I think it points to the fact that you need to have that discussion. It's not a one size fits all, is it?
Mm-mm.
It's really individual.
Mm-hmm.
You may feel that way. Somebody else feels a different way.
So. Yeah, it's every treatment's different. Mm-hmm. Every individual treatment's different.